I want to thank the museum, the Silver Sides Museum, and the staff, and Judge Neil Mullally for setting this up to bring me out here. It's I live in Silver Spring, Maryland, but I'm originally from Whitehall, and my folks, John and Marilyn, are here tonight. So it's my work is in Silver Spring, which is at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration headquarters. So it's a real honor that they were able to afford for me to come home for Thanksgiving. Thank you. I appreciate that. So your donations are well used, or at least we will find out, won't we? So tonight, towards the end of the evening, I'm going to be showing you sort of the main event, which is a 19-minute documentary on the USS Conestoga, which is a vessel which you're going to learn a lot about. But before that, because one of the things that I have figured out working for NOAA's Office of National Marine Sanctuaries is not too many people actually know who in the heck we are. How many people here have heard of the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries? Okay. Well, a handful. That's good. How many people here have been to a sanctuary? Where, Jeremy, where have you been?
I don't know if it's NOAA funded, but
so that would be probably an MPA is what we would refer to that as at the office, a marine protected area. They might sanctuary. The term is becoming more widely used, sort of the vernacular of areas in the ocean or Great Lakes that are protected. They're more and more the term sanctuary is being used, but actually there are only officially 14 national marine sanctuaries. Does anybody know where the closest one is? Alpena. So I have a couple clips of stuff that happens in Alpena. And Alpena, that is the Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary. And it's not just because I'm from Michigan, but the Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary is my favorite that I've been to so far. A lot of our sanctuaries, and they range from the Great Lakes, Alpena, to just north of, or just outside Boston, at the Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary. Now in Alpena, they take care of shipwrecks, and they educate the public on shipwrecks. Now at Stellwagen Bank, there's some shipwrecks there, but they take care of and observe and give habitat to mostly humpback whales. And then as you go further south, you've got the very first National Marine Sanctuary, which is the site of the Monitor. Anybody know what the Monitor is? Everybody should know what the Monitor is. So that ironclad ship from Civil War sits in about 250 feet of water, and some friends of mine are on the more qualified end of the diving community for the government, and they've dove on that. And there's only a couple people that have dove on that wreck, and they do it every few years just to sort of check up on that thing. Near there in Georgia, we have Gray's Reef National Marine Sanctuary, which protects what they call a live bottom reef, which is off the coast of Georgia. I have not yet been there. And then we go down into the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary. Has anybody utilized the resources in the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary? They have a really elaborate buoy system set up so that boaters can tie their boats up to the buoys and avoid dropping anchors into the reef, and sometimes the reefs are shipwrecks. But they do a lot of... It's probably the site with the strongest management protocol because there's tens and thousands of boaters in Florida Keys. Then as we move into the Gulf further, we have Flower Garden Banks National Marine Sanctuary, which is one of the most vibrant, it's about 80 miles offshore, reef systems. And we have to kind of work with the oil and gas companies that are out there who are some of our partners to help protect that site. Then as we work our way into California, we have the Channel Islands National Marine Sanctuary, which surrounds the Channel Islands, and the National Park Service is responsible for the islands themselves. And then we're in the waters around it, and that's another dynamic habitat. There's also shipwrecks there. And then as you go north, you have Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary. And then you've got the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary, which is where we're going to go later tonight when we talk about the Conestoga. And then the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary surrounds the Cordell Bank National Marine Sanctuary, which is a seamount that sits in the shallowest part is in about 150 feet of water, and it's a very dynamic environment as well. And then as you make your way north, there's the Olympic Coast National Marine Sanctuary. So that we have to work with several First Peoples, tribes, Native Americans out there, and we work with them and they work with us and we work with the fishing and the National Park Service. Olympic Coast National Park is one of, we were just there. So we partner with the National Park and at that site and many of the sites. And that's where I was most recently doing some diving, and I'm gonna have a video that I wanna show you about that in a minute. And then we make our way out to the Hawaiian Islands, and we have Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale National Marine Sanctuary, which is a species-oriented site, and it is what it sounds. We work to protect humpback whales. We recently tried to get public buy-in to expand that to an ecosystem-based site, and that sort of fell through, unfortunately. Even though we're sort of kind of already managing it as an ecosystem-based site already, it wasn't the political climate to get that accomplished. And then near there is a national monument, which is the Papahanao Makuakea Marine National Monument, which President Obama recently just expanded to over 600,000 square miles, which is the northwestern Hawaiian Islands. And there are many wrecks from World War II, from both sides of the conflict in that area, but it's also one of the most diverse ecosystems on the planet that's protected. And then finally, if you go all the way south of Hawaii, you will get to American Samoa. And we have a monument there called Rose Atoll. And then we have the National Marine Sanctuary of American Samoa, which is rumored I get to go there in February, which would be pretty cool. I have not yet been there. I've been to Hawaii. So what do I do for the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries? I am the videographer for the Education Outreach Division. So by order of Congress, a big part of what our office is supposed to do is engage and educate the public with all of the science and research that we do within the sanctuary. So a lot of the stuff that we do is probably similar to some of the things that are actually done at this museum. At least at the site level, you guys do an ROV competition here. That's a big deal at a lot of our sites. And I was actually helped start this up, started the Earth is Blue campaign in October of 2014, which is sort of an idea of mine. I should step back and say that before I came to NOAA, my thesis film at American University was on the space program. And it was from space that we first realized how blue this planet actually is. I believe it was the Apollo 8 mission. And so that was sort of trying to blend those two worlds together. I came up with the concept of Earth is Blue, and this campaign is an awareness campaign that we run through our social media, that we put out a photo a day and a video a week on any number of topics that have to do with the sanctuaries themselves, whether that's recreation, whether it's science, education. It could be a photograph that a surfer got while they were out on some lovely windy day in Hawaii, or it could be students picking up plastics on the beach. It could be people disentangling a whale in the Hawaiian Islands. But my team is responsible for the video a week that we create. And that is the goal of that largely is the same. It's to educate the public on the sanctuaries themselves and the people and the communities that interact with them. So tonight I've brought a number of pieces that I'd like to show you before we get to the Conestoga to sort of give you an overview of some of the things that I get to do in my capacity as the videographer for the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries. It's really a humbling honor to have this job. I have some friends that do similar work for the National Park Service, and you can consider us sort of the national parks of the ocean and the Great Lakes. And as you will learn later on, one of the things that's key to what we do is the archaeology on these historic sites, and that will relate very heavily to the discovery of the USS Conestoga, which we were going to get to towards the end of this. So I'm going to show you an overview video of our boss, who is Dr. Catherine Sullivan, talking about our Earth is Blue campaign. Now, Dr. Sullivan was a woman who was in the very first group of women to be asked by the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, to become an astronaut. And she's the first woman to perform a spacewalk from America. And she's also a distinguished oceanographer. And we're going to be very sad to lose her sometime in January. Just a remarkable woman. And this is her talking about our Earth is Blue campaign.
No matter what your zip code is, no matter what you see out your living room window or from your back porch, you are first and foremost a citizen of a planet and a citizen of an ocean planet. It's not a postcard and it's not just a pretty place to get your feet wet. The ocean is your life support system in a very real, direct way. It's as important for us all to take care of it as it's important for us to take care of our own homes and look after our families. Hashtag Earth is Blue, what better way to say it? People take care of things that they know are important to them or that they've fallen in love with. The first step to engaging folks in fabulous places like the National Marine Sanctuaries is get the word out there. The United States has 14 sanctuary sites and NOAA is charged with establishing them and running them and stewarding them so that they protect and help conserve all the critters and the great ocean assets that exist within them. They don't belong to NOAA, they belong to all of the citizens of the United States, just like our parks. The ocean is one of those places that is the archetype of that combination of power and fragility that struck me when I looked out the window of a space shuttle. We launched on my first flight from Kennedy Space Center in Florida. 8.5 minutes later, we were over England and 200 miles above the planet. When the engines finally cut off, I lifted my gaze and looked over the shoulder of the crew member in front of me and saw out this panoramic set of 6 windows, this broad arc of the limb of the Earth.
Well, we haven't seen much from this altitude that hasn't been spectacular.
It was all blue and white. Absolutely stunning. And I, without even thinking about it and totally unable to help myself, I blurted out, wow, look at that.
We'll be very proud and we'll be very honored that so many people will get to share.
You quickly discover we never should have named this planet Earth. That suggests terrestrial rocks, soil. And most of what you see from orbit is in fact the blue. Or if it's not the blue, it's the white that is the water that hasn't yet fallen back into the blue. This program that we're doing here today, Earth is Blue, is a product of the Sanctuary's office wanting to be sure you know about those great blue places. Social media gives us a really powerful avenue to do that.
You should see that view out there.
You know, back truck up.
We really can be nimble and showcase a lot of the different aspects, a lot of the different connection points to the sanctuaries that people can take advantage of. One is, they are places of really special national or international significance. From a natural resource or an archaeology or a cultural history point of view, can be hugely powerful connection points. The second thing is just setting aside those special places and leaving them in various degrees undisturbed ensures that we have safe zones, if you will, in the ocean where the natural resources of the ocean can continue to flourish even as human population grows and the planet changes around it. It's hugely powerful. We stand on the shore, we listen to the roar of the waves. That's part of the drama and power that draws us and attracts us and impresses us about the ocean. But it can give us a false sense that it is so immense and so powerful that it will always be fine and nothing we could do could ever matter. So the ocean is both hugely powerful and exquisitely life-giving. We truly do live on a blue planet. Help draw others to the opportunity, the obligation, the imperative, but also the fun and the real joy of taking care of the ocean.
So that's NOAA Administrator Dr. Catherine Sullivan. So that's just that was, again, a celebratory video that we did 1 year. So this would be October 2015. She agreed to sit down with us and talk about our project. And actually, my boss, who implemented this campaign, was just, our team was just given the Administrator Award for the Earth is Blue campaign, which is like the highest honor you can get at NOAA. So this is making waves, pun intended. So that went out in October, and then every week we come out with a different video. And so I wanted to show you what I was doing most recently in Olympic Coast. Jeremy, I think you just saw this the other day. So I'm a guy that's lucky enough to get suited up, sent into the ocean like that with a camera, and I have to film that stuff. And that was my boss going eyeball to eyeball with a Stellar Sea Lion, which weighs as much as a Volkswagen. And I got to tell you, if you haven't been in the water with those things before, it's quite an experience. I'd been in the water with California sea lions, and those are kittens compared to these things. Okay. So to give you an idea, that last shot in there, well, the second to last shot, there's a lighthouse on this island. That's Tatoosh Island. It's the most northernmost point in the continental United States. It's, you know, a couple miles away from Victoria. And there's a little rock about 50 yards off of that island on the other side of that lighthouse. And when we pulled up in the NOAA boat, it's actually named after that island, the Tatoosh. There were about 40 sea lions, stellar sea lions, sitting on that rock. Most of them were female, but there were a couple males there too. The males are the size of a large Volkswagen, so like a minibus or something. Not quite, but. And they're out there, and they're snarling, and they're beating up on each other, and you know, smacking each other with their heads and bumping into each other with their chests and all this. And my boss, Kate, who is the one interacting with one of the females there, sort of in this, I don't know, like she was having a spiritual moment. She just sort of stares out at this island and she goes, "We're going to have encounters." And I'm there like, I don't know that's a great idea. I don't know how I feel about this. Because apparently these males will like pin the divers on the bottom and they think that you're a female or something like that. And so they have their way with you. And you're very lucky, you know, if you can just keep your regulator in your mouth while all this is happening, let alone it's 40 degree water and you're scared. And so we had about 30 or 40 of the females swimming around us, and they get really close to you, as you can tell. They're very curious. Not very threatening. Fortunately, we never did have any of the males come up to us. But when we got out of the water and back onto the boat, we also noticed that none of them were on that rock anymore either. So, and at that point, the boat operators realized that our anchor was not coming back up off the bottom. So I had to jump back in, go down, and the anchor chain had like basically wrapped itself around underneath a rock, and then the anchor was sitting up on top of this rock. And when I say rock, I mean something the size of four Volkswagens. So nothing against German cars, by the way. So yeah, and then the sea lions, are, of course, are following you back up to the surface the whole time you're doing that. So that was August of this year that we did that. But it's remarkable to be able to do the people's work, be in the water with creatures like that, walk away from it, and hopefully have material like this that I can share with folks like all of you to show you what it's like to be in that environment, why it's, hopefully you understand why it's important at that point. The Olympic Coast itself is a very, very dynamic place. The tides there are brutal. The currents are brutal. We just happen to be there. The Pacific Northwest is famous for fog and rain, and we were there like the 2 weeks where it was sunny, flat, calm the whole time, which made for some really great visual opportunities. So moving along, I want to talk about the nearest National Marine Sanctuary, which, as the gentleman in the red sweater pointed out, is in Alpena, Michigan. Has anyone else been to Alpena? About 5-10 of you, maybe? Been to the museum there? Yeah? It's really a wonderful place. They have done fantastic things in terms of connecting the community that's there to the resources that are in Lake Huron. And when I say resources, I mean stories, which are in the form of shipwrecks. There are, 2 years ago, the site expanded from about 400 square miles to about 4,000 square miles, which means that we've got to figure out what the heck else is in that extra 3,600 square miles. And we think that there's another 100 at least shipwrecks that we're still looking for. And we work with the public to find those. It's not like we try and just hoard all this stuff and do it for ourselves. We love to work with the public on these things. Our budget's limited. But next summer, they're going to be going on this blitz to identify in breakneck speed wrecks in that expansion area. And they think that they're going to be able to identify them within maybe 24 hours. This is unheard of. It usually takes, there's a sonar survey. Somebody looks at that data. A few years later, they go and look at sites that might be interesting. They're going to be doing all this within like 3 weeks or something like that. So my first opportunity to go up to Thunder Bay was, during that expansion. But I got a chance to go up there with some of the archaeologists. And this is just some behind the scenes of what we were doing for 2 weeks to explore some of the shallower water wrecks that are accessible to recreational divers. Hey guys, this is Dave Ruck. I'm the videographer for Office of National Marine Sanctuaries, and we're finally here in Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary in Alpena, Michigan. Then we're going to head out on the Boston Whaler and dive on some wrecks. So this is a really exciting opportunity for us to test some new gear. A lot of these wrecks just haven't been documented that well. So today's the day we're going to start a week-long adventure, really, of getting great imagery of these sites.
Montana on the Foo. Saw several different shipwrecks from several different genres. They were doing many different things to make the Great Lakes one of the world's busiest waterways.
Mm-hmm. back in. So look forward to continuing on this week, looking at the footage we got, and then getting some more later on.
Probably one of the best weeks you can have at work, I would say. You know, this is good work if you can find it. So that is Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary. But Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary, yes, sir. Mm-hmm. I'm going to show you some of that here in a second. Yeah. I think to really tell the story of the sanctuaries, though, and to discuss the direction that we've taken now, I want to show you a piece. It's about 8 minutes long, about how Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary came about. And it wasn't a popular idea. There was this pushback, this idea that the government was coming in to sort of take over. And this is a documentary about a guy who was one of the most vocal opponents of the sanctuary coming in. But he kind of goes through a little bit of a change. And then after this, I'll discuss a little more of some of the things that are happening throughout the system.
People came in from outside and they're going to tell you what to do with what you have here. You know, give me a break. And they wanted to encompass a huge area. We, of course, objected. The whole idea of a sanctuary, that I think the sanctuary term, to this day, I don't think it's the best term for what the National Marine Sanctuaries are about, because to me, a sanctuary means keep out. Going to be restricted in any way diving any of these wrecks? And if so, was it going to cost us money? And what if we found a new one? Who's going to take ownership of it, so as to speak, when in reality it was ours to dive anyway, because that's just the point of view we had with it? Yeah, we were pretty vocal in terms of telling Noah to go home. Thunder Bay is appropriately named. If you try to do the charter operation like I did, trying to get divers out, I really only figure I have about 12 weekends. So when it's on, it's on. And you better go. And then with Thunder Bay shaped the way it is, it just kind of collects a lot of nastiness. And that's one of the reasons I think ships are where they're at out here, you know, because they ran into fog, they ran into everything, and you've got a collision. So I think it's earned its name, and it will continue to earn its name, I think.
Well, right now this morning, we're getting things ready to go out and remove buoys off the shallow water wrecks that are down in the Kelsite area. Those are buoys that a couple of us volunteer to remove and put back on every year for the sanctuary to help out with manpower deal. Philosophical reason why we have the buoys on there is to protect the wreck so people aren't throwing anchors into them and snagging them. Okay, we are off to Roger City Boat Harbor. I'm gonna launch this thing and see if it wants to run one of the prettier harbors.
You ready, Captain?
I'm ready.
Let's do it.
Put this hook in that chain low. That's guaranteed to stay. There we go. In the spring, we'll dive down there, find that little floaty thing in the chain, and just redo the reverse of what we just did.
One of our primary reasons to go diving was to bring back some artifacts if we found them, or at least some lumber, and make furniture, and it was all legal to do that. We found a few wrecks. We refound some wrecks that other divers had talked about, and then you threw a hook over the side, or a diver over the side, and see if you had something or not. Northwestern is a shipwreck about 5 to 7 miles off Roger City. A friend of mine, John Viglin, who is a good diving buddy of mine also, he was fishing and he found this wreck. He gave me his approximate coordinates and then got a friend of mine, Kurt Smitka, to come up. And the two of us made the first dive on the wreck. It had a lot of pottery on it, a lot of great stuff, and it disappeared one day. Those kinds of experiences for me over the years, to see that stuff missing, it was amazing how fewer people wanted to dive that wreck once those artifacts were gone. It just takes away from a lot of what a dive is all about. There's a lot of people out there that just crave that kind of stuff, you know. You know, when the law changed, I changed. And my feeling is it should be in a place like this.
So one of the great things about our visitor center, and you'd probably agree with me, is that it's bringing the bottom of the lake up to the general public. So people get to come here, learn about the artifacts, and even for people who can't scuba dive or snorkel or kayak over the wrecks, they get to enjoy these wonderful resources.
Divers are a minority, mm-hmm. and this is a way that we've kind of recaptured this whole maritime theme that's in Northeast Michigan.
Mm-hmm. We get thousands of kids from all over Michigan a year coming through here.
I thought it was pretty amazing that just the fact that I had been fairly vocal in objecting to the sanctuary, that they allowed for me to be part of the advisory council.
The opposition has been included in this process, and the realization now is that, and I'm probably a pretty good example of the fact that your opposition can become your strongest supporter.
It is a popular tourist type thing with lighthouses and ships and all that. It's just a natural attraction we've had with the water ever since we were on this earth, you know. But there's a greater thing that's happening in an effort to create that tourism that I see, and that is that people are getting together, that we are recapturing that history, that we are unifying and going to unify these three counties. Yes, in a goal to attract tourism, but at the same time, we're going to see each other in a little bit different light.
That's one of the things about the sanctuary program, is that it's about the landscape that we're protecting and the culture of these areas. And you know, the lakes are one thing. The Great Lakes are one giant thing.
There's a lot of wrecks out here that haven't been found yet. Wrecks that people are looking for, you know, and very significant wrecks, I think. That'll be neat when we do find them. I'm trying to find a couple of little wrecks, at least I hope to, trying to start a new stage in my retirement. Maybe you have a particular wreck that you want to go out there and look for. Probably what's going to happen is you're going to find something you weren't looking for before you find what you are looking for. So you don't know what you're going to find. You know, you get the clues and try to do the best you can. One of my favorite things to do on any wreck that has some kind of an intact bow is to go down the bow to the bottom, stand on the bottom some distance away, and just let it run you over.
Now this is going to become part of the sanctuary. The sanctuary ends way up that way at the end, the northern end of Presque Isle County, and goes all the way over to the international border between the United States and Canada. So basically, as far as you can see in any direction right now, you are within the boundaries of the sanctuary. So it's an excellent, excellent feeling.
So that's a little introduction to Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary. As luck would have it, Steve eventually became the volunteer of the year for the entire system. So the entire system, from American Samoa, Hawaiian Islands, West Coast, East Coast, North Coast, South Coast, this guy in the Great Lakes who was sitting in a room telling the government, like, no, we don't want you here, he became the volunteer of the year. And he's at every meeting still. He's just an incredible guy. I mean, he's an institution himself in that region. And, you know, all these things that he's collected that have been in his garage that his kids don't even want anymore, that he's been pulling off wrecks because he's just got so much stuff. You know, it's finding its way into a museum. And it's really an honor to get to meet people like that. You know, so they send me around to the sites to interview and talk to folks like that. It's really interesting when you come across somebody who was against the whole idea at the beginning and then has become like an ardent supporter. There's talk of another sanctuary occurring in the Great Lakes. Has anyone heard about that yet? Yes, no, maybe? Yeah, kind of near there. Tristan, right? Hey, how's it going? Yes, they're thinking of calling it the Lake Michigan National Marine Sanctuary. And that, so the way it works is, for the first time in 20 years, 21 years, the gates have been open to allow the public to nominate new sites. So this hasn't happened for a while. And one of the first towns or communities to really get their stuff together is Three Rivers, Sheboygan, and I think it's Port Washington, together have submitted a proposal for their piece of lake to become a National Marine Sanctuary. So what that means is they have to figure out with us, how big is that site going to be? What is it that we're protecting? How are we going to protect it? Are there going to be any laws or limitations on use? But then there needs to be a really strong educational component to this as well. How are we going to utilize those resources to educate the public and engage the public to create opportunities for students to learn, maybe to put a museum up that's going to then, you know, bring in tourism to the community? There's all sorts of questions that sort of need to be answered and need to be answered really, really well before we put our stamp on, like, okay, we'll review this. And then it goes through a whole process before it will actually become designated. So we're sort of in like the halfway point with a sanctuary becoming a reality in Wisconsin. There's another one that they're thinking about doing in Maryland, and Erie, Pennsylvania put in a really robust proposal as well, because they're seeing like what's happened in Alpena, Michigan, and instead of having opposition, they're basically just begging for these opportunities at this point, which is great for us, but we also need money to, like, you know, establish these things as well, which of course is another difficulty. I wanted to show one more piece about Thunder Bay, which is really for some of the educators here, to show exactly how that education takes place and how one particular teacher is using that museum and using the human capital of the NOAA folks that work there, and tying that into his classroom.
Run through your list of archaeology observations one more time. Make sure that you have as much information on each wreck as possible.
My name is John Capeless. We're at Alpena High School. Shipwreck Alley is a class that was designed to cover all aspects of marine sanctuary operations. So what makes Shipwreck Alley exciting is that I can create some pretty powerful learning opportunities for the students. The class is really built around earth science. This is an earth science classroom. Shipwrecks run aground, so we can talk about some of the unique geology. And then we move on to meteorology. Storms, fog, wind, waves, they all cause shipwrecks.
Imagine yourself out on the Great Lakes in November.
Talk about resources, natural resources in the region. Then we do some archaeology, which really opens up opportunities to work with the sanctuary. And in the end, we tie it all back into lake ecology and how the lakes are changing and how we keep the ecosystem thriving.
We're looking for propulsion type, right? So if we want to identify the ship, we have to figure out if there's any machinery that indicates it's a sailing vessel or a steamer.
I couldn't wait to connect the sanctuary with my students because I knew they could create opportunities for my students that I couldn't do alone.
Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary is like a museum under the sea.
Everything that we do that's really cool in this class has Marine Sanctuary hands on it. They feed us a lot of the real world information that brings that learning alive, and they create the fieldwork opportunities, or they help me find fieldwork opportunities.
Check out one more wreck. Do we have time for one more?
Yeah. This particular class, Shipwreck Alley, doesn't exist anywhere else in the world. We started with a pilot program of 30, one class, 30 students. The next year we went to three classes, about 90 students, and then we went over 200 students the third year of the program. The idea that we're exposing two-thirds of every kid who graduates from Alpena High School to Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary and its mission and the positive effect it has on the community, I think that's a powerful thing. I love the fact that I get to partner with the sanctuary. Every person on that staff is positive and has a can-do attitude. Things get done around there, and it's been an amazing thing for our community.